In this video, we will learn about the concept of heredity. In our previous video of reproduction, we have seen that each and every living organism give birth to its offsprings. These offsprings, they are getting the same basic design from their parents, but they are not the exact copy of their parents. There are certain changes in these organisms, in these offspring. These small changes are called variations. It's not that these variations are not producing asexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction also, these small changes are produced. But these are less as compared to the sexual reproduction. Now, these offsprings, they are having certain variations in their bodies. Now, when these offsprings get mature and again give birth to their offspring, means the second generation. This second generation is inheriting the variation of the first generation as well as certain new variations will be added up to this second generation also. So in this way, these variations keeps on accumulating. All offsprings of the same parents are not similar. They are certain changes, and these changes are known as variations. So in this figure, this is very much clear that how variations are accumulating generation after generation. These variations can be useful for that particular organism, or these may be harmful. So the organism with harmful variations, they cannot survive for long, and they are deleted from the planet by the nature. On the other hand, the organism with useful variations, they can adapt better in their surrounding. So these are selected by the nature. These variations, not only important in survival of the organism, these are the basis of evolution. If variations are not there in the organism, then the process of evolution can also not occur. Now, what exactly is heredity? The process of transferring the characters from parents to the offspring. Just now, in my previous slides, I inform you that offsprings, they are inheriting the basic body design from their parents. It means parents, they are passing the characteristic to their offsprings. Now, how is it possible? How parents are passing the characters to their offsprings? Living organisms, they are made up of millions and trillions of cells. And all the living cells, we know that they are having a nucleus, except a few. And inside the nucleus, there are chromosomes. These chromosomes are made up of DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. A specific part of this DNA, which is responsible for controlling a particular trait, is called a gene. So, these genes are responsible for transferring the trait from parents to offsprings. These genes, they are having all the blueprint of the body. So parents are passing the blueprint of the body design, of the body structure, of the body function to offspring in the form of genes. This process of transferring the genetic information from the parents to offspring, then to next generation, then to next generation, is called inheritance. So you can see in this figure, cell. Inside the cell, there is nucleus. In the nucleus, chromosome, and then DNA, and then the gene. Let us study some common inherited trait that we can clearly observe in our surrounding. Earlobes. Earlobes, they may be free or they may be attached. Like in this figure, you can see the first figure, first picture is showing the attached earlobe. And the second one is showing the free earlobe. This attached or the free earlobe is an inherited trait. Observe your earlobes and your parents' earlobe and just observe the similarity in the trait that you have inherited from your parents. Whether you can roll your tongue or not. Again, this you are inheriting from your parents. Try to roll your tongue. Observe the same trait in your sibling, in your parents, in your friends, and tell your friends also to observe in their sibling and in their parents. Inheritance of hair color or inheritance of hair shape or inheritance of skin color. These are some of the traits that you can very clearly observe. The first person who studied the concept of inheritance was Gregor Mendel. He is also known as father of genetics. He performed his experiment on pea plants, Pisum sativum. What is special about pea plant? In pea plant, one can clearly observe these seven pairs of contrasting traits. Seed shape, whether it is round or wrinkled. Seed color, it is yellow or green. Pod shape, is it inflated or constricted? Pod color, is it green or yellow? The flower color, purple or white? The location of the flower, is it axial or is it terminal? Or the plant size, whether it is tall or short? In this figure, observe the flower of the pea plant. Now, what is special about this flower? Just observe the arrangement of petals in this. It is very clearly indicated here that the arrangement of the flower is such that it doesn't allow pollen grains to go out of the flower. It means pollen grains, they do not have any other option than falling on the stigma of the same flower. It means self-pollination is the rule in the pea plant. Now, let us study some of the common terms that we are going to use in the concept of heredity. Gene, just now, I informed you in my previous slide that a stretch of DNA which is responsible for controlling one particular trait is called a gene. It is the basic unit of inheritance. And gene, they always occur on pairs because we are having two sets of chromosomes. So we are having two different forms of the same gene on these two different chromosomes. So different form of the same gene that control the contrasting form of the same trait. For example, say height is the gene and the two different form of this gene may be the tall height, may be the dwarf height. So this tallness and dwarfness become two alleles. but the gene is for the height. Homozygous. When the two allele of the same gene, of the one gene, they are similar. For example, tallness, tallness, dwarfness, dwarfness. Then that is homozygous. But if these two alleles of the same gene are different, tallness with dwarfness, then it is called heterozygous. How these alleles or a gene is going to express in the organism, or we say the physical expression of the gene, is called phenotype. Whether the plant is going to appear tall or dwarf, whether it is going to have the purple color flower or the white color flower, this is the phenotype. And the genetic makeup, which is responsible for this physical expression, is called genotype. If a plant is appearing tall, we say that its phenotype is tallness. But the gene responsible for this tallness may be present in the homozygous state or in the heterozygous state, that we are going to study in the forthcoming slides. That will decide the genotype. Dominant. When two contrasting alleles of the same gene, they are coming together, but out of these two, only one is expressed. The one that is expressed is called dominant, and the one that failed to express is called recessive. Now let us study about Mendel experiment on the pea plant. He selected pure pea plant showing the contrasting height. Now, what do you mean by the pure plant? Pure tall plant means when cell pollination occurs in this plant, in next generation, all plants, all 100% plants, they are going to be similar to their parents. Similarly, when we are saying dwarf plant, it means when cell pollination occurs in dwarf plant, all 100% plants, they are going to be like their parents, means dwarf. So he selected pure breeding tall plant and pure breeding dwarf plant. And he hybridized them. Now, just now I have informed you that only self pollination can occur in pea plant. Then how this is possible? This was made possible by two techniques, emasculation and bagging. Now, what are these two techniques? The removal of the pollen grain is called emasculation. He opened the petals and he removed all the anthers from the flower. And he sprinkled the pollen grain of selected flower of the selected plant on the stigma of this flower, and he covered this with a polythene bag to avoid the contamination from unwanted plants. So these two techniques are emasculation and bagging. So though cell pollination is the rule in pea plant, but cross pollination can be done by emasculation and the bagging technique. So let us come to his experiment. Mono hybrid cross. Mono hybrid. The cross in which inheritance of only one trait is studied. That is called mono hybrid cross. For example, in this cross, only inheritance of height of the plant, pea plant, is studied, or in fact, was studied by Mendel. As just we have done, that he selected pure breeding tall plant and pure breeding dwarf plant. And when cross-pollination happened in these two plants, in next generation, what he was expected to observe was that the plants may have the medium height, or maybe some plants tall or some plant dwarf. But he was surprised to note that all plants were tall. Now, he let them self-pollinate. And what he observed, that when self-pollination occur between these two plants of F1 generation, he called these F1 generation, first filial generation. In next generation, or F2 generation, or second filial generation, he observed that three plants were tall and one dwarf. This was the ratio that he calculated when he counted all the plants on which he performed his experiment. The ratio came out 3:1, that is three tall and one dwarf. This cross can be expressed in the form of a flow diagram like this. Capital T is to represent tallness and small t to represent dwarfness. Gamete always have the single allele. So from the dwarf plant, only small t will come, and from the tall plant, only capital T will come. So when these two gametes, they will fuse, then in the next generation, the genotype is going to be capital T and small t. And all plants appear tall. So that shows tallness is dominant over dwarfness. This was F1 generation. Then what he did, he allowed them to self-pollinate. In this case, it was cross-pollination. But in F1 generation, self-pollination. So now, the gamete may have capital T or may have small t, because this is heterozygous. Earlier, parents were homozygous, but here the parent is heterozygous. Remember, in homozygous, only one type of gametes are formed, but in heterozygous, different types of gametes are formed. So now when there are two parents, and there is a possibility that capital T, small t can be there in one parent, similarly in another parent, again there is a possibility that gamete may have the capital T or gamete may have the small t. Now we can represent the result in the form of a square. This is called Punnett square. So now we see the result. We see that we get the ratio 3 tall plant, 1 dwarf plant. But if we try to represent it in the form of genotypic ratio, then we get 1 homozygous tall, 2 heterozygous tall, and 1 homozygous dwarf. So we can say that 3:1 is the phenotypic ratio, and 2:1 is the genotypic ratio. So now this 3:1, 3 tall, 1 dwarf, is known as monohybrid cross ratio. On the basis of his monohybrid cross, Mendel gave two laws, law of dominance and law of segregation. Law of dominance says that when two pure parents with contrasting traits are cross-hybridized, then only one is expressed in the next generation. The one that is expressed is called dominant, and the one that remains unexpressed, not expressed, is called recessive. The other law he gave was the law of segregation. According to this law, when two parents contain two alleles during gamete formation, the factor or the alleles of the pair, they segregate from each other in such a way that a gamete receives only one of the two factors. So we cannot use the term homozygous, heterozygous for the gamete, because gametes always have only one of the two factor. That is why we say that gametes are always pure. So this law is also known as law of purity of gametes. Mendel also studied dihybrid cross, a cross in which inheritance of two traits is studied simultaneously. So in this dihybrid cross, he studied the inheritance of yellow colored seed and round shaped seed with green colored seed and wrinkle shapes. So two traits were the color of the seed and the shape of the seed. Again, he selected pure plant, pure pea plant with yellow colored and round shaped seed, and pea plant with green color and wrinkle shaped seed. By monohybrid cross, he already knew that yellow color is dominant over the green and round shape is dominant over wrinkle. But he wanted to study that if these two traits come together, then how inheritance occurs. The genes or the alleles representing yellow and round shape can be written as capital R, capital R, capital Y, capital Y. This is indicating the homozygous state. Similarly, green color and wrinkle shape is represented by small r, small r, and small y, small y. Again, homozygous state. So the first step is say cross-pollination by emasculation and bagging. Only one type of the gamete, because it is the homozygous state. So now the gamete is having single allele for the color, single for the shape. In F1 generation, he observed all offspring were having round shape and yellow color. Now what he did? He allowed self-pollination and self-fertilization among the plants of F1 generation. Now, because this is a dihybrid cross, so now it can form four different types of gametes. In monohybrid cross, we have done that a heterozygous parent can form two types of gamete, but this is a dihybrid cross. In a dihybrid cross, heterozygous parent can form four different types of gamete. So four different types of gametes from one parent, four different types of gamete from other parent. This is the Punnett scale. Now try to fill each and every column. Like suppose this one YR, this one is YR. So the result become capital Y, capital Y, capital R, capital R. Now say this one. This is the cross between this small YR and this capital YR. So now what will be the result? I think now you can write it yourself now. Right? So in this way, try to fill all column and rows. And now try to find out the phenotype of these offsprings. When you will observe, you will find yourself that out of these total 16 combination, 9 are round and yellow, 3 are round and green, 3 are wrinkled and yellow, and only 1 is wrinkled and green. Now, the question is that parents, they were of round and yellow type and wrinkle and green type. Then how come that we got 2 new phenotype in this? How is it possible? These 2 are new combination in the next generation. That we say variation. So these offspring, these 2 different category, 3 round and green and 3 wrinkle and yellow, these are showing variation from their parents, from their offsprings. How this is possible? This shows that when 2 traits are there and these 2 traits are inherited simultaneously, then these are inherited independently. Means the color of the seed and the shape of the seed are inherited independently. There is no compulsion that shape is linked to the size. It is because of this independent inheritance of these 2 particular traits here that we are getting 2 different types of phenotype. And the ratio, it is represented as 9:3:3:1. This ratio is known as dihybrid cross ratio. We have done 3:1 as monohybrid cross ratio and 9:3:3:1 as dihybrid cross ratio. On the basis of dihybrid cross, Mendel gave his 3rd law, law of independent assortment. This law says that when 2 pairs of trait are combined in a hybrid, the segregation of 1 pair of character is independent of the other pair of character. These 3 laws, law of dominance, law of segregation, and law of independent assortment, are collectively known as law of inheritance given by Gregor Mendel. Now, a very big question. How do these genes control all traits of the body? Structure of the body, functions of the body. Now try to understand this structure. Inside the cell, there is nucleus, and inside the nucleus, there are chromosomes, and these chromosomes, they are made up of DNA. And I have informed you earlier that these DNA is having the blueprint. Now, what do you mean by this blueprint? It means that it is having all the information, all the instruction. Instruction for what? For making the proteins. The structure of the body made by proteins. All functions of the body catalyzed by proteins, enzymes. Immunity of the body, protein, globulin. Contraction, movement of the body, proteins, actin and myosin. So you see that the structure and the function of the body are controlled by proteins. And the information for making these proteins is there in the DNA, in the genes. So if gene is active, a protein will be synthesized, and now this protein will do the cellular function. For example, just now we have done that the particular color is produced in the plant. Now this color is the result of some chemical reactions, and these chemical reactions are catalyzed by proteins. So if protein is present, chemical reaction will occur and a particular color will be produced. If that particular gene is not there, proteins will not be formed, chemical reaction will not take place, and color will not be produced. This I have given you just one example. In the same way, all functions of the body are controlled by proteins, in turn controlled by genes. Now comes the concept, sex determination in human. In reproduction chapter, we have done the complete process of a baby formation. That how gametes fuse, a zygote is formed, then the zygote start dividing, it get implanted into the uterine wall, this grows into an embryo, then into fetus, and then a baby is born. But in this complete process, we have not studied how the sex of this growing baby is determined. So now let us study the sex determination. We all know that each and every human cell is having 23 pairs or 46 chromosomes in the nucleus. Whether it is baby or a girl or a boy or a male or a female, every human is having 23 pairs, or we say Homo sapiens are having 23 pairs of chromosomes. In each and every human being, out of these 23 pairs, 22 pairs are same. These 22 pairs are called autosomes. So autosomes, they are similar in all, irrespective of the sex. But the 23rd pair of the chromosome, this is different in male and in female. This 23rd pair, because this is different in male and female, is called sex chromosome. In female, this is called XX, and in male, this is called XY. Because these two are similar in female, so female can also be termed as homozygous, and this is different in male, so it can be termed as heterozygous. Male, heterozygous, female, homozygous. Now, at the time of the sexual reproduction, gametes will be formed. Female will form only one type of gamete, 22 plus X. Because in earlier slides, I have informed you that in homozygous condition, only one type of gametes are formed. So by female, only one type of gamete, 22 autosome, and one sex chromosome, that is X, because female is having both the X chromosome. So 22 plus X. But the gametes produced by male heterozygous are of two types. 22 autosomes, but there are two combination, 22 autosome plus X chromosome or 22 autosome plus Y chromosome, because male is having two different type of sex chromosome, X and Y. So two different type of gametes are formed by the male, 22 plus X, 22 plus Y. So now, at the time of gamete fusion, this 23rd chromosome X may fuse with the X of the male, or this may fuse with the Y of the male. So if combination is XX, this zygote will develop into a baby girl. But if it is XY, if XY are there in the zygote, 22 pairs of autosome and 23rd sex chromosome XY, then this zygote is going to develop into a boy. 50% of these offsprings, they will be boys, and 50% girls. As you have seen, all the children, they are inheriting one sex chromosome from the mother. Whether it is boy or girl, they are inheriting X chromosome from the mother. But the second chromosome that they are inheriting from the father may be X, may be Y. So if the zygote is receiving X chromosome from the father, this is going to develop into a girl. But if it is inheriting Y chromosome from the father, it is going to develop into a boy. So now, who determines the sex of the child? Father or mother?